Hi, I'm Philip Noble, and I'm standing here in the town square of Jacksonville, Alabama. Now, behind me is a marker that boasts some of the history of this area. Jacksonville was first called Drayton, but in 1834 it was renamed to honor President Andrew Jackson. Now, it used to be the county seat, but it moved to Anniston in 1899, which is about 10 miles south of here.
Calhoun County originally was Benton County, named for Colonel T.H. Benton, Creek War Officer, later U.S. Senator from Missouri. Renamed in 1858 for John C. Calhoun, champion of the South in the U.S. Senate. Benton's views by then unpopular in the South. Calhoun County thus offers a 19th century example of renaming. Of course, Americans have been renaming the landscape for centuries. When the Pilgrims resettled the abandoned American Indian village of Patuxent in 1620, they renamed it Plymouth. Notwithstanding this tradition of change, when names get challenged today, some people raise a generic objection. We can't rewrite history. Well, rewriting history is hardly the issue. The question is, whom do we choose to honor from our history? Comparing the man Calhoun County now honors with the man whose name was taken off the landscape in 1858 provides a useful lesson. Now, John C. Calhoun never set foot in Calhoun County, while Thomas Hart Benton probably did. Otherwise, the careers of the two men show several parallels. Both were wealthy slave owners. Both were important United States senators and national leaders of the Democratic Party. And both were considered for the presidency. Calhoun served as vice president under Andrew Jackson, for whom the city of Jacksonville, Alabama, where this sign is located, was named. Gradually, however, Calhoun and Benton diverged in political philosophy until they became archenemies. Calhoun took ever more extreme positions, favoring the South as a region and slavery as a cause. Over and over, he used the threat of disunion to blackmail national leaders to get what he wanted. Calhoun explained his strategy in a letter to a friend in 1827.
"You will see that I have made up the issue between North and South. If we flinch, we are gone. But if we stand fast on it, we shall triumph either by compelling the North to yield to our terms or declaring our independence of them."
Opposed to the high tariffs of 1828 to 1832, Calhoun prompted a national crisis when he got South Carolina to nullify them. Andrew Jackson refused to back down, declaring, "Our federal union, it must be preserved." Calhoun's threats did get congressional leaders to lower the tariff, however. Having browbeaten his way on the tariff, Calhoun later threatened disunion if Texas was not annexed, if the United States extended diplomatic recognition to Haiti, and even if citizens in northern states continued to agitate for abolition. In the 1840s, Calhoun insisted that because the Constitution protected slavery, slave owners had the right to take their property into any of the territories. This meant that Congress had no right to pass the Northwest Ordinance, which outlawed slavery in the land that would become Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, Illinois, Wisconsin, and part of Minnesota. Calhoun also labeled unconstitutional the Missouri Compromise, which he had supported in 1820, and which admitted Missouri as a slave state, but banned slavery from all other territories north of Arkansas's northern boundary. Calhoun's purpose must have been disunion, or, in the words of Teddy Roosevelt, who wrote a biography of Benton, wanton malice. He knew that if the federal government forced slavery into the territories, regardless of what their inhabitants desired, Northerners would not tolerate it. In 1837, he had noted that states' rights allowed Northerners to distance themselves morally from slavery. A large portion of the Northern states believed slavery to be a sin and would consider it as an obligation of conscience to abolish it if they should feel themselves in any degree responsible for its continuance. Nevertheless, he now threatened that the South would secede unless the federal government passed and enforced a harsh fugitive slave law. Meanwhile, Thomas Hart Benton, Missouri senator from 1820 through 1850, became more and more convinced that the United States should be preserved. Always a slave owner, he insisted that he would always defend slavery against the abolitionists. Increasingly, however, he came to believe that slavery was wrong and should not be allowed to expand. In 1849, he declared,
"If there was no slavery in Missouri today, I should oppose its coming in. If there was none in the United States, I should oppose its coming into the United States. As there is none in New Mexico or California, I am against sending it to those territories."
Benton pointed out that Southern Democrats had opposed secession when New England Federalists had threatened to secede during the War of 1812. The leading language, south of the Potomac, was that no state had a right to withdraw from the Union, said Benton, and that any attempt to dissolve it or to obstruct the action of constitutional laws was treason. Despite Benton, by 1850, Calhoun's agitation for secession had borne fruit beyond his home state of South Carolina. After complicated maneuvering, a compromise between sectional interests emerged in which the North won acceptance of California as a free state in return for a harsh fugitive slave law. Benton and Calhoun both opposed the compromise of 1850. But from opposite perspectives. Benton argued that California met the requirements for statehood and should be admitted without bargaining with radical slaveholders like Calhoun. He denied that the Constitution protected slavery and urged Congress to exclude slavery from the territories. A dying Calhoun threatened disunion one last time, claiming that the compromise didn't go far enough in guaranteeing slavery forever. It is doubtful that any compromise would have satisfied Calhoun at this point in his life. In 1858, in keeping with the growing secessionist sentiment in the plantation areas of the Deep South, pro-slavery extremists in Alabama renamed Benton County for John C. Calhoun. They took this step precisely because Benton stood for the United States, while Calhoun did not. As Roosevelt put it, the extreme pro-slavery men honored Benton with a hatred more intense than they harbored toward any Northerner. Am I making too much of a name? Who cares for whom a county is named? Who even knows what Calhoun did these days? To leave the name as it is, on the premise that nothing is really meant by it, is to trivialize John C. Calhoun. And John C. Calhoun was no trivial figure. Taking history seriously requires taking Calhoun seriously. Another viewpoint is that even though Calhoun was a malevolent force in our history, he is part of our heritage after all. Why not just respect the past by leaving it be? We take our heritage seriously when we learn about it, think about it, and debate it. In 1991, when Russians changed the name of Leningrad back to St. Petersburg, they were respecting their past. The policies, writings, and beliefs of V.I. Lenin had caused much harm in the world, especially in Russia. Leninism now stands discredited in many minds as well as on the Russian landscape. The policies, writings, and beliefs of John C. Calhoun similarly have caused much harm in the world, but they hardly stand equally discredited, partly because, unlike St. Petersburg, Benton County is not yet known again as Benton County. To be sure, we can't change what happened in the past. We can change what we think and say about it. Renaming Benton County told more about the white men who did it than about Thomas Hart Benton or John C. Calhoun. The renaming reveals them, like Calhoun, as advocates of slavery at any price. Leaving it Calhoun respects their long discredited position today. Indeed, every year the name remains Calhoun County, it declares on the landscape that John C. Calhoun was a hero worthy of having a county named for him. Of course, this is an insult to every black resident of the county and every white resident who does not believe that treason on behalf of slavery made moral or political sense then or now. Benton, on the other hand, struggled with and wrote about issues of race relations, politics, and economics. Though he never attained consistency, his ideological movement was heroic for his time, and studying his interesting life and books would be time well spent for anyone interested in race relations, politics, or economics today. Perhaps, when Calhoun County is again named Benton County, students will be motivated to spend this time.
Change my name. Change.